I'm going to start by acknowledging something. I'm not a border researcher or a scholar. So, but before I get booed off the stage for not being one, back when I was about 28 years old, I decided I had worked too long and decided to retire, liquidated everything, took my money and said, okay, I'm going to go travel. And that took 4.5 years for me to bleed through my money. And over those 4.5 years, I encountered every border imaginable. I hit hard borders, porous borders, open borders, bribable borders, hidden ones, invisible ones, anyone, there, every one of them. So I guess you could say I have experiential knowledge of borders. And one area that I'm really interested in when I was traveling was Southeast Asia, China, Myanmar, and where I research now in India. So I suppose that's why Victor asked me to introduce Tom, because of the geography. And there's no doubt that when you look at China's Belt and Road Initiative, that it's transforming spatial relations and certainly borders in many ways. It's reestablishing connections from the old Silk Route, road, I should say. It's creating entirely new routes and new connections. And then it's also drawing upon other roads, other trade routes that are lesser known. In the case of Myanmar, you're looking at the T-Horse Road that connected Tibet down to Kunming in the Yunnan province and then down into Myanmar, Laos, and the tea-producing areas. So there is a historical legacy to this initiative of the Chinese Myanmar Initiative. So I think it's a really interesting topic. And Tom has been working in China, and I guess primarily the Yunnan province now, for 9 years. His area of study is hydroelectric power and its impacts on ethnic communities and the environmental consequences in the new river valley, which is in the border region. Since his initial research, he's expanded his research to look at cross-border energy flows. And that's certainly relevant to the Myanmar-China Road and Belt Initiative, because it's connecting, or it's scheduled to connect, Kunming to the Bay of Bengal and through the Rakhine province, a state that everyone knows about. Right? So Tom, however, is not just limited to the Yunnan province or energy research. He's traveled extensively through southwest China into the remote Dulong River Valley. He is actually walked across the border, that's something we shared, walked across the border into Myanmar, definitely illegally, by the way, not possibly. I did that also from Thailand into Myanmar during the civil wars that are taking place there. That's part of that porous border I was talking about. He's also traveled into the regions of eastern Tibet, where he acknowledges that he was not recognized as a reincarnated Lama, despite trying to be acknowledged so. His approach to research consists of dynamic engagement. He's extended the notion of participatory research to include his family. He traveled with his mother on a motorcycle up 5,000 meters in the Hengduang Mountains. She hasn't forgiven her for that. But also, I was wondering, this could be an episode for that TV show. I don't know how many people have heard of this, the 50 Ways to Kill Your Mama. My daughter watches that, writing down notes, but I think it's more directed towards me than her mother. Okay. Tom is also very proud of his cultural exchange programs when he does his research. His greatest achievement was teaching some local Tibetans how to shotgun beer. So he's a mountaineer, he's an adventurer, he's a road warrior, and that's about all the accolades I'm going to give to you. I'll now yield the podium to you, sir. So, please welcome Tom.
Thank you very much. Good morning. It's morning in China right now. How many folks in the room have either been to China or have some sort of experience of what's going on in China? Okay, so about half of us. How many also know anything about the Belt and Road Initiative? Okay. So here is really what I'm trying to poke at today. You know, how has China leveraged its geostrategic location of Yunnan province, the borders, and trans-regional energy development to really lay a foundation for projects that are really starting to manifest now under the BRI, so the Belt and Road Initiative, or China's global vision is another way to think about this. So China's energy landscape, you know, as we all know, or should know, rapid economic growth has shaped a really consistent increase in energy demand and energy generation, but really particularly since the early 90s. I'm going to show a number of graphs, a number of sort of data sets early on, and they're all going in the same direction. And they all have relatively sort of the same launch point around the 1990s. This is when Deng Xiaoping really started to open China's economy up to the outside world. China's energy landscape by 2040, China's energy use will be double the United States, okay? If we're gonna have any types of even basic conversations about climate change, we really need to pay serious attention to China, okay? Past the US in 2010, and again, moving very rapidly in one direction. So it's just trying to think about what are some of the consequences of that immense energy use. And I'm going to take you through actually what this sort of looks like on the ground and how this has played out in one province of China and how borders are really crucial to this whole venture. So you can sort of conceptualize China's energy landscape as this dramatic contrast or a real contradiction. You have on one hand, by far and away the largest burner of coal on the planet for many years. About 75% of China's thermal generation has come from coal. They've brought that down into the 50s, but still dramatic, far and away in front of the second place. In 2030, China is predicted to overtake the United States as the world's leading consumer of energy. But China also is the world's largest investor in renewable technology. It has the largest amount of generation for renewables. So it's really this contradiction here. We have on one hand the world's largest carbon emitter, the world's largest polluter, burner of coal, and almost, you know, to be the user of oil, but also the largest developer of renewables. So if we're talking about emissions, we're talking about climate change, how is China working to decarbonize? And what does that renewable energy landscape actually really look like? Hydroelectricity is a gigantic part of what China's doing. So currently, China has about 341 gigawatts of installed capacity, and that's the most in the world by a really long margin. The US has 102 gigawatts, Brazil 92, and Canada about 80. But we can see here, it's not only what China has now, it's also what China's planning to do in the future. I don't have a laser pointer here, but I want to sort of direct your attention to these dam building plans for China and where the spatial concentration of these dams are occurring. They're occurring in the southwest, and that's because you have most of Asia's major river systems that are cascading down from the Tibetan Plateau through Yunnan and Sichuan province and either down into China proper or turning and moving across the borders into Southeast Asia. So let's go on a little journey south of the clouds, and this is the province that some of us in the room here are very fond of. This is Yunnan, and the two characters or ideographs that actually combine to make the word Yunnan translate as south and clouds, so south of the clouds. And this is because Yunnan was always a frontier, a very peripheral place to Greater China. It was always the backwater, full of savages and barbarians outside of the sort of realm of Imperial China. And it wasn't incorporated into sort of Chinese dynastic control into the Yuan dynasty in the 13th century, which is quite late when you consider China's long, complex history. So it's the sixth largest province by land area And it has approximately 47 million people. The last census was in 2016. It also has a really dramatic cultural landscape as well, the sort of ethnic mosaic that all, you know, those of us who have been there really see, and it's really sort of evident. So 26 of China's 52 officially recognized ethnic minority groups, known as Shaoxu Mingzu, but also many are unrecognized groups as well. So about a third of that 50 million are actually ethnic minorities. And it's a place that, although it has, you know, immense natural resources, it's actually quite underdeveloped comparative to the rest of China. So it's the third poorest in terms of GDP per capita. And in fact, if you go way up into some of the really remote parts of the province to the New River Valley or the Dulong River Valley, some of the prefectures there are amongst the poorest in the country. So a real contrast again. But Yunnan is developing rapidly, and I'll take you through some of that in this presentation. What Yunnan has a lot of is water. So 600 rivers, 222.2 billion cubic meters of water resources. But it has five major transboundary rivers. Okay, so we have the Nu, which is the Salween once it crosses the border into Myanmar and forms the border between Thailand and Myanmar. We have the headwaters of the Irrawaddy, which is actually the Dulong River. We have the Lansangjiang, which is the Mekong in Southeast Asia. The Honghe, which is the Red River in Yunnan before it crosses into Vietnam. And we have the Pearl River, which goes into Guangdong province and transits out into Hong Kong. So what does that actually translate to in terms of hydroelectric resources? So if Yunnan was a country, it would be fifth in the planet in terms of installed hydroelectric capacity, behind Canada, but in front of India. So that just in terms of scale, you know, we sort of create either sort of international borders or provincial borders and sort of think of Yunnan as a province. But we really need to think about these things deterritorialized and consider the immense scale of hydroelectricity. Here is the time scale of how, you know, the hydroelectric generation and capacity has developed in Yunnan. And there are really sort of two stories here. One is everything up until the early 2000s. And then we have a really different sort of a real takeoff here, okay? So we have about 10 gigawatts up until 2007. And then we have about 50 gigawatts of generation happening in that time period. So that is just a dramatic, you know, from sort of zero to hero overnight. And that's a sort of common story that you'll sort of hear in many parts of China and see this in terms of the rapid scale of development. So let's sort of think about how Yunnan has been positioned and how its borders have been used to move it from this conceptual backwater to a place that's really central now to China's geostrategic objectives. So Darren McGee coined this term, the power shed. If we think about a watershed, a river, he conceptualized the province as a power shed. To detail what was happening there in the mid-90s to the sort of 2000s. Hydroelectricity that was generated in Yunnan was primarily transmitted for domestic markets and predominantly Guangdong province. And this was under a policy called Xidian Dongsong, send Western electricity east. So really here, borders tended to operate in a fairly orthodox manner. Sites of containment, control and regulation. And there's a lot of history too. China and Vietnam only formally, they fought a war on the border there in the 70s and 80s. They only formally signed their agreement in 1999. So when you consider the amount of history between these two places, you know, and China has only technically been a country for 70 years, that's really quite recent history. We have ongoing conflict in Myanmar, still to this day. So the borders here really were sort of functioning in the ways that many borders in many other parts of the planet function, as these sort of sites of containment, regulation, and control. Yunnan was really positioned here as a space to spur domestic generation. So in 2006, China's president Hu Jintao first coined or used the word Chao Tou Bao, which means bridgehead. And that was talking about Xinjiang province, which is another sort of frontier area. And this is a military term that sort of denotes a gateway or a leverage province. So first it was Xinjiang, then it was Heilongjiang in the northeast up on the border with Russia. And then he said Yunnan should really take advantage of its geostrategic location on the border with Southeast Asia and open up. So the geostrategic position of Yunnan was leveraged to start to extend geoeconomic and geopolitical interests across the GMS. And that stands for the Greater Mekong Subregion. And these are the states of Myanmar, Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam. That term, Greater Mekong Subregion, was a product of the Asian Development Bank, of which the major shareholder is Japan, and a large shareholder is the United States. So now we can start to see a bit of the geopolitical posturing in this region, okay? In this time period here, between sort of 2010 and 2016, Yunnan's import and exports to Southeast Asia doubled from about 1.7 billion to about 3.4 billion. And borders began to really open up here. You can see this image, Yunnan. This is when I was living in Yunnan doing my dissertation research. 13 additional international border crossings opened. Border crossings that were already open started to see these really rapid increases in activity and infrastructural development. The two characters that actually denote the term border crossing in Chinese, it's Guomen, and it translates directly to Kingdom Gate. So when you go in towards the border, you'll see a sign that'll say Guomen, and it'll have an image of an old imperial city with a little door on it. So yeah, now we start to really see things changing in Yunnan. We start to see a lot of investments flowing into the border areas. We really start to see cross-border trade starting to proliferate rapidly. So from the power shed to the bridgehead. And the policy here was around specific to hydro was send Yunnan electricity outward, okay? So from sort of send it east, now it's send it out. I came up with this term, an energy conduit, because to get published in a, you know, academic journal article, Laurie's laughing, you have to come up with some fancy term. But this was really with a lot of the work that I'd spent on the border observing. And the image here on the right is in the hills behind a city called Rili. And the scar in the earth is the oil and gas pipelines that start in the Bay of Bengal there, at Kaikafu in Myanmar, and transit all the way through, cross the border into Rili, and continue on into Kunming and to Guangxi province. So I think this image is really instructive because you can see the pipeline, the scar of the pipeline, and the transmission lines. But what can't you see? Anyone see the border? Where's the border? Yeah. It's somewhere in that image, right? So when I started to think conceptually about the ease of flows of energy or flows of raw material that were sort of crossing the borders with impunity, and I started to think about how Yunnan had evolved from a power shed, it was really acting like this conduit. Energy, electricity that was generated in the province was predominantly moving out, and resources that were coming into the province were moving through. A lot of the investments that were centered from Yunnan were moving outward into neighboring states. What this was doing was really starting to bolster the economic, regional sort of economic integration between China and the states of the greater Mekong subregion. Not just hydroelectricity, but also oil and gas. And there's another sort of geopolitical argument about this pipeline is that it circumvents China's need to go through the Malacca Straits. The pipelines themselves only supply just 3% of China's oil and gas needs. So the question then is, why are you investing such huge sums of money to develop this infrastructure? Okay, as I'm going to try to demonstrate, it's not just about the infrastructure. It's what the infrastructure lays the foundation for that comes after. So borders now, from being sites of containment to opening up, are really these sites of connection and connectivity. And when you go to cities like Rili that are small on Chinese standards, you start to see the massive amount of investments and 300 to 400 buildings going up overnight and huge highways. And it's really quite shocking, the scale of development in these border regions. So what does this actually look like? What is this all about? Okay, I'm not going to take you through this. This is not just an image of the electrical grid in Yunnan. This is just an image purely of some of the major transmission lines that come from the hydroelectric dams. What I want to point your attention to are these three arrows on the southern border here. You have electricity moving across into Vietnam, and has Yunnan has been transmitting electricity across to Vietnam since 2004. It's been transmitting electricity across to Laos, and it's been transmitting electricity and importing electricity from Myanmar. And that should pose a really logical question when I asked it. Why, if China has these immense energy needs and these huge demands, is it sending exporting electricity to countries like Laos and Myanmar and Vietnam? Electricity, hydroelectricity in this sense, is a Trojan horse, okay? So, China is, as we know, investing in infrastructure all around the world. Predominantly, its expertise is in hydroelectricity and hydropower. It makes its own turbines, so it's really active building dams in many parts of the planet, okay? Predominantly, it's building dams in Southeast Asia. Number of BOT hydropower projects. So BOT stands for Build, Operate, Transfer. And these projects start as BOT projects with the guise that they will eventually be transferred over to control by the governments of or the stakeholders downstream. But that doesn't always happen, okay? They are saddled with sort of concessional loans because countries like Myanmar and Laos don't have the capital resources to build these types of structures. So China has the expertise, has the capital. It says, we're going to come in and build these dams. We'll give you a soft loan, okay? And after a number of years, you pay us back. Then we'll transfer ownership over to you, okay? So let's look at the energy profiles of some of these countries. You have Vietnam. You have an installed capacity at the moment of 4.5 gigawatts, a theoretical capacity of 18. And as I mentioned earlier, has been importing electricity from Yunnan since 2004. Thailand, similar numbers, 3.5 gigawatts, maximum theoretical capacity of 15, but most of the sort of technologically, economically, or politically viable hydropower in Thailand has already been developed. Laos, installed versus theoretical, 0.7 gigawatts, but a theoretical capacity of 30, okay? Second most potential on the Mekong, and we have all of China's major hydropower firms competing to develop these dams along the Mekong River. Myanmar, installed versus theoretical, 0.7 again, but 37 gigawatts. Myanmar has, you know, huge amounts of untapped hydroelectricity. It's developing massive reserves, but it's also China's facing competition from Thailand, because Thailand is also a regional player that wants to develop dams in Myanmar and import the electricity. Okay, so we have some really interesting data. There is a lot of data on this. So this is the China Global Investment Tracker. And this is 2005, you have the time scale on the bottom, to 2019. These are all of the sectors that China is investing in globally. And by far and away, we can see that energy stands above all others, okay? So more than double the next, which is transport. But we're going to sort of scale down into Southeast Asia here. It's going to tell us, and we'll play around with the time scale. It's going to show us some interesting results. So if we go to the Belt and Road Initiative, you can isolate just the Belt and Road, certain parts of the planet. Similar story, okay? About 690 billion, still predominantly energy. So let's look at Myanmar here. So from 2005 to 2019, we can see energy was one, metals was two, and transportation was three. But if we isolate this to the last 2 years, we see a very different story. We have sort of massive investment in transportation. Okay, why? What's going on there? And energy has really dropped off. If we go to Laos, over that time period, far and away still energy is first, transportation is second. If we focus on the last 2 years, transportation is the largest sector, okay? Here is actually what this looks like. When you move through these places on the ground, this is what high-speed rail development looks like in China. Okay, and Victor's nodding his head there. We've driven past that quite a number of times on the way to Dali. Here is another image, though. This is actually in Laos. Okay, so this is part of China's desire to integrate, economically integrate this area. And I think this is really fascinating because you can also see the transmission lines up on the hill in the background. And we have the signs that are popping up everywhere in Laos now, construct the Laos-China Railway, benefit the Laos and Chinese people. And it's like wonderful friendship. Everyone is going to gain immensely from this. Also, transmission, well, this is, you know, smaller scale distribution lines in the background, okay? So what is this all about? Let's look at Cambodia. Again, 2005, 2017, predominantly energy. And the last couple of years, energy is completely gone, and it's transportation. So we can see here, this is an image that sort of really lays out what's happening in this part of the world. If we remember, under the Obama administration, there was an announcement of the strategic pivot towards Asia Pacific. At that time, Secretary of State Clinton was the first Secretary of State to visit Myanmar. She visited twice, and Obama was the first US president to visit the country. Why are they going to Myanmar? Okay, this is about sort of geopolitical and geoeconomic influence in the region. So we have China building the road in the north to the large dam, and we have the US in the south. We also have, you know, the Asian Development Bank, largely Japan, and also Thailand. So this is China really asserting itself in its backyard, okay? And how it's doing this is that it started through electricity. So electricity was, you know, hydro was the Trojan horse in the sense. And you develop these type of complex business relationships, and you develop the transmission infrastructure. And then it's like, well, we'll come in and build the road for you. And we're extending our railway down here too, okay? And guess what? We have the expertise and we have the money. So it's from energy to roads and rail. And really, what we need to be thinking about, not just the geoeconomic and geopolitical posturing of all these actors, but the immense environmental consequences. For us that have been to China, we just see this unbelievable contrast of a place that's developing so rapidly, but has some of the most unbelievable consequences, visibly on the landscape and certainly the air particle pollution as well. Okay, and this is in a part of the country where there is relatively minimal air pollution. But this is what road building looks like. This is on the upper Mekong River. This is the last time we went to the New River Valley. This is 300 kilometers of road construction at once. Okay, and they send in the earth movers and they just completely destroy, you know, countless homes and move everyone out, and they settle them in these large sort of towers. Okay, these people that are living in the border regions. It's about settling people, keeping them controlled, but also keeping China's growth engine moving too. So these projects in many ways are about energy, but they have immense energy demands. And we have to really think about the environmental consequences. China doesn't have its own way all the time. Okay, so there is a lot of resistance. And there's a lot of evidence of some countries saying, no, we're actually going to cancel the projects. This one is the Mietzon Dam on the Irrawaddy, a hugely controversial project that China has cancelled, Myanmar has cancelled, and faced huge amounts of pressure from the Chinese. We also see Malaysia cancelling China-backed oil pipelines and railways as well. So why is that important? And what's this really all about? Okay, I'm going to sort of wrap up here. When China, when Deng Xiaoping, this immense vision to transition a command economy of the size of China's to a market-based economy, they'd never done it before because something of that scale had not been done before, and they'd never done it. They didn't know how to do it. So what they did, they crossed the river by touching the stones. And what that means is they engaged in a series of experimentations. Okay, rather than just saying we're going to go from a command economy to a capitalist economy, they did all of these series of experimentations over time. And what this means is that China is using Yunnan province, and it's not crossing the river by touching stones, but it's actually crossing the border by touching the stones. It's using Yunnan as a site to experiment, because it's not just Yunnan that China's going out from, okay? And China doesn't need stones to cross the river anymore. It has bridges, a lot of them, and they're really big. So in terms of new directions at the border, we have China in motion, we have Yunnan in motion, and we have borders in motion. And, you know, what I've noticed in my time working in China and becoming more familiar with the border studies is that there's a lot of focus on either the border itself or one particular dimension of the border. And this is really sort of thinking about Victor's article, Borders in Motion, that borders are always moving. But it's not just the borders that are moving, okay? All of these other phenomena are moving at the same time. So I developed, a team of us, this term relational motion. So it's not just that the borders are in motion. It's not just that China's in motion and that Yunnan's in motion. It's that all of these things are in motion at the same time, and they're all relational to each other. If you focus on sort of one particular dimension, you're missing all of the others. So it's about looking beyond the borders and looking at multiple dimensions of this phenomena and trying to sort of work your way back to the border, I guess. And now we land on this term, Yunnan as an integrative energy center. So there is another policy. It's called Fushi. And that translates to sort of radiation center or sort of pivot. And Yunnan is now really a core. It's central to China's broader geostrategic objectives. So energy is both a sort of strategy and a policy, and it's working to sort of further these geopolitical and geoeconomic initiatives, but it's what it's actually doing is working to integrate the grid through the greater Mekong subregion. And through grid integration becomes further economic dependency, and China is moving further towards its broader objectives here. So conclusions. Yunnan functions as a geostrategic center. So it's gone from a periphery to a power shed to a bridgehead to conduit, but now it's really central. And it's uniquely positioned for these ongoing experimentations as part of China's broader grand strategy. Borders are critical. They provide points of primary connectivity while also offering access to secondary markets downstream. So it's not just China's interactions and relationships with Myanmar and Laos and Vietnam. It's also Malaysia and Thailand and Indonesia. But through Yunnan, you have the ability to sort of work and integrate all of those other states and other markets. These transboundary rivers are these multi-sided connectors. These are the things that bring all of these places together. And the transregional energy projects provide initial foundation. They create the economic integration and dependency, and they really pave the way for additional it's really what comes after the energy that we should be focusing on. Not, you know, it's the roads, the telecommunications, that's what's happening now. And again, if we think about that as a sort of parable to, you know, borders in motion, let's not focus on what's happening now. Let's focus on what's happening, going to happen in the future. How can we predict the future? Well, we can look to the past. This is where I'm going to end. This is the broad strategy here. And this is China moving closer and closer towards this larger geostrategic goal, powering the Belt and Road. China doesn't want to dominate the world territorially like other hegemons have done, the United States, and take control of territory and build military bases. It's buying the world, or it's loaning it the money, economically integrating it, and everything, whether it's Yunnan province or other provinces, all of the benefits are flowing back to China. Thank you. Ailey. Oh, we need to get the microphone.
That was just fascinating. When I was in Tibet in 1998, some Tibetans told me that when the Chinese were building the road to Tibet, some of the Tibetans had thought it was a good idea. And do you think that Myanmar and Laos are going the way of Tibet?
This is a great question. Who does development benefit is really what you've asked. You know, I've seen this in my work in the village. I've seen this, you know, on a broader scale. Here is the simple answer, although it's way more complicated. I've never been anywhere where Tibetans or people in the New River Valley have said, we don't want development. However, there are certain types of development that further embed these sort of spatial inequities. And road building is actually one that, you know, when I went in to do my dissertation research, for example, I was so focused on the dams. And I came out of it realizing the biggest benefit to a lot of these communities was actually the roads they built to the dams. A lot of people still miss out. Okay, you have to have certain types of, you know, either capital, education or be sort of located somewhere close to a road that you can really take advantage of that infrastructure. And on the scale that I've showed you today, it tends to sort of further create these gaps, because it's the way that these things are implemented. It's like, here is a road. You're going to be, you know, your life is going to change dramatically. Or here is a dam. And for, you know, mostly agrarian folks or people that are doing whatever, that doesn't make a lot of sense. To answer your question. Well, just take my example from working in the New River Valley for so many years. When I started going out into this part of the world to do my research, a lot of the folks had, a lot of the villages had only just recently got electricity, and many of them didn't have any roads. And I did, you know, a sort of ethnographic study, and I asked every single household, every person, you can have a road, a hospital, a church, or a school. You can have one of those things. Which one do you pick? I think 98% picked the road. Okay. So it's like any type of large-scale infrastructure development. It tends to be really divisive. The people that are already sort of in a decent position tend to sort of benefit exponentially, and people down the bottom maybe have some minor impacts, or they're further marginalized.
Thank you for this very interesting presentation. It's fascinating. I might not be an expert, but I mean, the companies are all Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
All of them. The companies that are building that infrastructure. My question is, they are all Chinese based. They are not other companies that are fighting for the construction of this infrastructure.
It depends. Yeah, I mean, in Southeast Asia, certainly some of the projects are multilateral projects, and there are multiple different stakeholders.
And the gas. Natural gas pipeline, the one at the border.
Yeah.
Why was it constructed exactly there?
The straight line route to get from the port where they had the terminal facilities straight towards Kunming. It was just literally straight line.
But it's just, I mean, why is it constructed like this? I'm sorry, I don't understand. I mean, it's not my area of expertise, but you showed that the border was there, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's just because of the connection, I mean, because of the facilitation, or it also serves another purpose?
I'm not really understanding your question.
You think the route was along the border?
Exactly.
No, it just transected the border.
Transected the border.
The pipeline went straight across the border.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't understand. I thought like that it was like that, so I didn't. Yeah. Oh, okay, great, thank you.
Oh, that scar, the photo.
Uh huh.
That was the pipeline. Uh-huh. They just buried it under the ground.
Okay. It was it crossed the border. I was like, okay. Yeah, thank you.
It's a remarkable dissertation, this is, but it's very troubling, actually. You know, when we say that China is going more and more towards renewable energy, clean energy, that is not so. Because if you build the dam, you are going to be building it with fossil fuel to begin with, and you're going to drown a whole area of forest that is essentially a carbon sink.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is lost.
Mm-hmm.
So over the lifespan of this dam, you've lost a huge carbon sink, and that's not clean energy.
Nothing's clean energy.
No, exactly. Nothing is clean energy. And we are, in fact, subsidizing, in the West, we're subsidizing China to destroy the climate by importing the so-called solar panels, which are energy hogs to begin with, to manufacture them. And I doubt very much if over their lifetime of operation, they will recover the carbon dioxide that they've already dumped into the climate during that process of manufacture.
Mm-hmm.
So we are losing. We have to really sit and think about this?
They're really interesting questions to grapple with. Dams are definitely not carbon neutral. Just think about the amount of concrete, the turbines, the power stations, the associated infrastructure, the transmission lines, the roads that you have to build to them, the reservoirs, the space they take up. But neither is solar. You know, they have silicon, they have rare earths that are mined somewhere, probably in the Congo. You have a supply chain that gets them, they're produced in China and then transmitted elsewhere. Wind turbines have large gearboxes that require a lot of oil and generators. The thing with energy is you can't get something for nothing. Okay, there are always impacts.
But wouldn't it be better to burn fossil fuel over a longer period of time than build all these humongous projects that are basically dumping 20 or 30 years worth of fossil fuel in 1 year or in the year of their production?
I tend to think anything is better than continuing to burn fossil fuels. To burn fossil fuels, we know the direction that we're headed. And I think at least investing in, this is just in hydro, gives us a chance. Dams are removable. And we can start to experiment with other technologies that have less sort of compounded carbon costs. But if we continue to burn coal, and if we continue certainly to burn coal on the scale that China's been burning it for a number of years, we're never going to even get close to resolving the challenges that we're just starting to see with climate change.
I don't think I made myself clear. We are burning the coal to begin with, but we are burning it over a much shorter period of time. You know, we are burning coal, 30 years worth of coal, to manufacture solar panels that will only displace that carbon dioxide over 30 years operating without burning coal. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I haven't seen the data of the amount of coal it takes to produce a solar panel, the electricity. But
we made these solar panels for operation in space. We knew that
right.
It would take a lot of energy to make these solar panels.
Sure.
In space, it's okay, but to manufacture them on the scale that we are doing on the planet's surface is madness, in my view. We should make an energy audit, not a money or a financial audit. Then we will be able to find out whether they are worthy or unworthy.
Hmm. Good point.
More questions? People are running out of gas.
Literally.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.